Then Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, anyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So, if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." She counseled, she did all the things that pastors do. She just learned never to pray for somebody. Well, she was flying one day on a plane going across the country when a man sat down next to her who turned out to be a businessman who was very powerful, very wealthy, but got his money, earned his money in a kind of, well, let's say less than honest sort of way. A conversation between the two of them ensued when he noticed that she was reading the Bible. He said, "Oh, the Bible, I love reading the Bible." And he went on to talk about his faith and his life, how he was a Sunday school teacher, how he was an active part of the men's group, and how he worshiped at church every Sunday. Then he went on to describe his business life. And he said, "You know, business is business. My industry is one of those cutthroat, dog-eat-dog kind of industries. So I do what I've got to do just to survive. But that's not really who I am." Well, the pastor suddenly in that moment finally realized why it is she received the gift that she had. So she turned to the man and she said, "Could I pray for you?" Well, the man was absolutely flattered, so she began to pray for him, and sure enough, within the first couple of words of her prayer, the man opened his eyes and he said, "What a fool I have been all of my life." And then he said, I just can't believe in God anymore." Well, the next Monday, the man went to work, and it was pretty apparent how things were just different. He didn't like his job as much as he used to. You see, he used to be able to justify himself as a man of God, but now he just realized he was a cold and calloused businessman. Well, for about 2 weeks, it just got worse and worse until finally he had a breakdown and he had to quit his job. Well, as he was recovering from that whole experience, he began to open up a little bit more. And he began to feel a little bit more free. And he began to become more generous with all of the money that he earned. He even used his business acumen, his intelligence, to help those who had been chewed up and spit out by the system that he was once a part of. A couple of years later, he happened to see this pastor again in an airport, and when he saw her, he ran up to her, he fell at her feet, and he said, "Thank you so much for setting me free and helping me to find my faith." Today, I want to talk about the Reformation. And this is the commemoration of the 500th anniversary of Reformation. We will have 60 million Lutherans all over the world gathered together in worship and praise because of this Reformation anniversary. But it's more than that. It's been quite a year of build-up. Our Lutheran Church, our ELCA, has done some amazing things, including reaching out and doing that reconciling work, for example, with the Catholic Church. And things, the Holy Spirit has been hard at work, and there's been so much wonderful excitement, but today I want to get through all of that excitement. I want to get through all of the, anything that might distract us from the very heart and basic core of the message of the Reformation, which I believe can be summed up in just one single word, and that word is freedom. Did you hear it when I was reading John chapter 8? How many times that word was mentioned? Jesus says, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Freedom. But I know that I have to be careful when I talk about freedom today in this culture, because I am not referring to a freedom that's very popularly defined in our culture as just the freedom to do whatever we want, or the freedom to do whatever our heart tells us to do, or whatever we feel. No, I am talking about a much deeper kind of freedom, a freedom that is more ancient than that. It is the freedom that Luther discovered as he was translating Paul's letter to the Romans. It is the freedom that Paul, 1,500 years before, discovered as he had his conversion experience. It is the freedom that the prophets like Jeremiah, whose words were read today, or Isaiah spoke about. It is the freedom that God has always wanted his people to have, for example, the Israelites, who were led out of bondage and slavery in Egypt. It is the freedom that we were given, Adam and Eve were given when they were set in the Garden of Eden. It is the freedom that we are created to have so that we can freely respond in love. That is the freedom that I want to talk about today. But I also realize that it's dangerous to talk about that freedom. And the reason why it's dangerous to talk about that freedom is because of God's word. You see, what God wants to give us freedom, and in order to do it, he has got to penetrate through the hard shell of our heart into the deepest, darkest recesses. The places where we hold our insecurities, where we hold our addictions, where we hold our fears, the place of messiness. He's got to get his word all the way in there. And by the way, we all have that place. We are all messy people. And do you know who are the messiest of the people? They are the ones that look like they got it all together. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's good news. We all struggle. For Luther, it was the fear of being imperfect. Maybe that's a fear that you have. Or maybe for you, it's a fear of being abandoned. Or maybe it's the fear of insecurity. What is it? What is it that you struggle with deep down in that place that God wants to get to bring his light? You know, this condition is what Martin Luther in the Reformation called incurvatus in se. Actually, I was corrected at the last service. It's incurvatus. Apparently the V is a W. I've always said incurvatus, but anyway, incurvatus in se. And it's a beautiful image. That's Latin, by the way. And it's a beautiful image. It's a big Latin word that we probably don't know, but really it is a picture of a human being curved in on themselves. And that's the condition, Luther says, that we all struggle with. And in that condition, we can still look normal. We can still do good things and do good works. Hence the man who was able to justify himself. Business is business. But God wants to get into that place and set us free from that place. And the way he does it is through his word. It is that simple. He wants to come into that place and remind us that we don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be perfect. We will never be abandoned. Can you hear that simple word this morning? It is the simple word of the gospel. And yet we resist. Can you simply be still and know? Be still and know that you are loved. And it doesn't have anything to do with what you've achieved or what you haven't achieved. It is simply who you are. A beloved child of God. And when you know that, you are set free. Set free to live the life that you were created to live. Set free to be fully alive. And that freedom is not a freedom of, oh, now I can just do whatever I want. That's not it. Instead, we are free to love. Free to serve. That's who we were created to be. You know, it's interesting, last Sunday, as I was thinking about what I would preach upon this Sunday, I was nervous because I didn't know if I could follow Pastor Steve and his great sermon last Sunday, his teaching sermon. And then I was listening to our local radio station, KCLU in the house, right, over at California Lutheran University, and there was a story on. And the story was about a scientific experiment. I don't know if it was psychologist or sociologist or whatever, but here's how it went. There was a group of scientists who wanted to test the pain threshold that people experience when they dip their hands into icy cold water. So they got the first group, and it was just a group of individuals. And they had these individuals dip their hands into icy cold water, and then they recorded how much pain they felt. Then the next group was a group of people who knew each other. And so two at a time, one person would stand across from their friend, and then they would dip their hands in the icy cold water. Do you know what happened? People actually felt more pain. Because now they were not only feeling their pain, they were feeling the pain of their friend as well. It was painful for them to see their friend going through pain. I know you know that experience. So then finally they had the third group, and the third group was two people that didn't know each other. So they would dip their hands in the ice, and do you know how much pain they felt? It was the same amount as the first, as the individuals, not as much as when you knew the person. While they were finished with the experiment, what they next did was they had those two people that didn't know each other, they had them interact with each other. There were several groups, and what they did to interact with each other is they played a video game called I think it's called Rock Band. Is that a name? Thank you, Abigail. I appreciate that. Rock Band. So it's a collaborative video game. You're not playing against each other. You are. If you have one console, you're the guitarist, and then you're the drummer and all that stuff, and you make a song together. So they had these two strangers play together and do a song. And after 15 minutes up, they gathered him around the ice bucket again, and they dipped their hands in the water, and guess what happened? They were now feeling more pain. The pain of a friend dipping their hands in the ice water. And I thought that was just, it was just amazing for me to hear. But then in the end, do you know what the conclusion of the commentator was? The conclusion was, see? We are genetically wired not to care for strangers. And I thought, what? That is absolutely the wrong interpretation. Instead, we are genetically wired by our Creator to love our neighbor. And if we can hear that word, and if that word can penetrate our heart and turn us from being in-curved to going out, that is exactly what we will do, even when it hurts. Because that's who we are when we are fully alive. We are loving God and we are loving our neighbor. That's the joy that we experience. That's who we are created to be. When we know that, when we are set free, God will use us like He has done in so many reformations, big and small, throughout the history of the church. And we will change the world. Amen.